Hi, everybody. I'm Katie Price, Curator of Collections here at the Williams College Museum of Art. I just want to thank you all for coming out. Happy spring, I think. It's really nice to, I think, usher in the first few days after spring break here at Williams with a program on Warhol and cookbooks and Wild Raspberries, Warhol's collaboration with Suzie Frankfurt. So I'm really excited to have Susan Rossi-Wilcox and Darra Goldstein with us this evening. This is the second in our series of programs for Warhol by the Book. These conversations are meant to be fun, informal, deep dives into one aspect of Warhol's career and life. I'm especially thrilled to welcome Susan and Darra tonight. Darra and I started thinking about a program around Wild Raspberries, I think about a year ago, when I found out that Darra was teaching a course on the cookbook through history as part of the Book Unbound initiative here at Williams. And I'm just, to welcome two people with such extensive expertise in so many areas beyond the history of culinary arts. So just to give you a little bit of a taste of their backgrounds tonight, Susan Rossi-Wilcox was the curatorial associate at the Botanical Museum of Harvard University and the administrator for the Glass Flowers Collection before she retired in 2007. She's been the recipient of the Rackow Research Fellowship from the Corning Museum of Glass and was a visiting scholar at the Max Planck Institute for the History of Science in Berlin. She has curated several exhibitions on glass and was the guest curator at the Andy Warhol Museum in Pittsburgh for Reset Satire, Andy Warhol's and Suzie Frankfurt's Wild Raspberries in 2008, and Andy Warhol's Wild Raspberries at the Butler Institute of American Art in Youngstown, Ohio. Rossi-Wilcox has lectured extensively, reviewed books for the Journal of Popular Culture, published articles in a variety of topics on the history of science, and has written three books, including Dinner for Dickens, The Culinary History of Mrs. Charles Dickens Menu Books, and contributed an article in Reading Andy Warhol in 2013, along with the Oxford Companion to Sweets in 2015. Susan holds a BA from the University of North Carolina at Chapel Hill, a master's degree in the history of science from Harvard, and a chef's diploma from the Cambridge School of Culinary Arts. She has also served on the board of overseers for the Handel and Hayden Society in Boston, and on the board of directors for both the Glass Art Society and the Culinary Historians of Boston. Darra Goldstein is the Willcox B. and Harriet M. Adsit Professor of Russian at Williams College. She is founding editor of Gastronomica, the Journal of Food and Culture, named the 2012 Publication of the Year by the James Beard Foundation. She holds degrees from Vassar and Stanford and has published numerous books and articles on literature, culture, art, and cuisine. She has organized several exhibitions, including Feeding Desire, Design and the Tools of the Table, 1500 to 2005 at the Cooper Hewitt National Design Museum in New York. She is also the author of four cookbooks, A Taste of Russia, The Georgian Feast, which was named the 1994 IACP Julia Child Cookbook of the Year, The Winter Vegetarian, and Baking Boot Camp at the CIA. Goldstein has consulted for the Council of Europe as part of an international group exploring ways in which food can be used to promote tolerance and diversity. And under her editorship, the volume Culinary Cultures of Europe, Identity, Diversity, and Dialogue was published in 2005. Goldstein has also consulted for the Russian Tea Room and Firebird restaurants in New York City and served on the board of directors of the International Association of Culinary Professionals. She is currently food editor of Russian Life magazine and series editor of California Studies in Food Culture from the University of California Press. In 2013, she was named Distinguished Fellow in Food Studies at the Jackman Humanities Institute at the University of Toronto. Darra is editor-in-chief of the Oxford Companion to Sugar and Sweets.
No wonder I'm so exhausted.
And we're all getting hungry. And her new cookbook, which I'm particularly excited about, Fire and Ice, Classic Nordic Cooking, will appear from 10 Speed Press in October of 2015. So please join me in welcoming Susan and Darra.
I'm really excited to be up here with you, Susan.
We've crossed paths a lot over the years. Yeah. When I first came to Williams in 1983, my lifeline to the world was the Culinary Historians of Boston, where I think we first met many years ago.
Yes.
So it's great to have you here at Williams.
Thank you. I'm so enjoying being here, truly. And this museum is magnificent. The exhibit is exceptional, absolutely exceptional. So
we want to just, sort of talk about Andy Warhol and cookbooks and food and sweet things. And I'm particularly interested in wild raspberries, which you've done so much work on. Because one of the things that I like to talk to my students about is the fact that recipes are a form of communication. And if you look at the recipes in wild raspberries, and maybe mm-hmm. you can describe some of them, I would like to know what you think that they're communicating, because most of them are not reproducible.
Basically, I look at it as a way of Suzie Frankfurt and Andy Warhol looking at being in their time. I mean, they're in the 1950s. It's after the war. The social situations are changing so rapidly. And the way people look at the good life is changing. And there's this attempt to really look at European food, particularly French food. And French food is always, has at that time, and through greater parts of history, French food has always been thought of as the standard, a great standard. And so Suzie Frankfurt is a young wife. She's just learning homemaking and entertaining. She's a woman from California, and she meets Andy Warhol because she saw his exhibit, loved the work so much at Serendipity, and they made arrangements to meet and became fast friends. And through this friendship, they realized that they had this interest in terms of cooking and how complicated French food was. And she's looking at this, I think, as a way of entertaining and doing a good job. And apparently her mother was a very good cook, and she wanted to attain that standard, at least. So her mom, according to interviews, her mom had sent her cookbooks, and she looked through them, and there's a statement that she makes, which is something like, they say, make a bechamel sauce, and I didn't even know what that was. So it's very basic sauce, but she didn't know what it was. And I think this is a way for them to look at that situation that other people were going through as well, in terms of looking at good cooking, looking at food, and thinking about it in terms of how complicated it is. And from that point, it becomes then a satire. It becomes a parody of these cookbooks. And I think, to my mind, that's what this then becomes.
So not really a cookbook, but a spoof.
Completely.
And there are recipes for things like roast iguana, which you can't find at your local store. But it also brings in a lot of realia. So Trader Vic's is mentioned, Abercrombie and Fitch, Cadillacs, and all of these moments where it's very grounded in the reality of New York City in 1959.
Yeah, it very much is grounded in the reality. There's, for example, there's a trend towards barbecuing. People who are moving out into the suburbs. A lot of people after the war are getting married. They're building houses. They have more room. Their houses are larger. Freezers, for example, are becoming available at prices that people can afford. There's an entire industry that came from the war effort in terms of dried potatoes and canned juices and meat in a can and those sorts of things, and frozen food, and this is all available. And so there are products like Lucky Whip is one of the products, and there's
it's like Cool Whip.
Cool Whip, yeah.
I know.
It's in a can. Yeah. Which I think they still make. And stores like AMP are there. Trader Vic's is one. And Trader Vic's is really interesting because at the GIs, many of the GIs were stationed overseas, and a lot of them were in Hawaii. There's a baked Hawaii recipe, and Hawaii becomes a state in 1959, the year that this book is made. In August, I think, it becomes a state. And the book they put together between September and October in 1959. So there are these references that are very much 1950s references. And it's really, I mean, the genius, Warhol's genius, is being able to look at the American scene and the social situation and really focus in particular ways in that. And that's what I think actually Wild Raspberries does very nicely, because not only is it a spoof on French cooking and really making fun of just the elaborate preparations that need to be made, but it pulls in the Americana in ways that sort of smooshes it all together and becomes then the parody that are these recipes that are the text.
I like the idea of smooshing. I think it's a really good verb to use. What I love about the book is the way it has the highest, you know, the French haute cuisine, and drawing from great French cookbook writers like Dubois and Escoffier. But then there's things like Lucky Whip that you only find in lesser establishments. And I think it reflects Warhol's own interests, because he would regularly dine at the fanciest restaurants in New York, very expensive, like Trader Vic's or Cafe Nicholson or La Grenouille, which he really liked. But his heart was with Schraft's and with Chock Full of Nuts. That's and these lunch counter kinds of places where he could just go and have a good meal and not have all of the effete around him, except that he was at the same time drawn to that very effeteness.
Yeah. Well, and I think also another thing that's really interesting, another really interesting aspect of this book, is that there are 24 so-called recipes in it, but 16 of them, they've taken excerpts from Escoffier, and it looks as if, in really just wonderful ways, and a lot of times, I mean, when you look at Escoffier's recipes, I mean, they're
maybe
serious.
Explain who Escoffier
is. Escoffier is one of, he was the chef of kings and the king of chefs, and he was the turn of the century cook. He worked with Cesar Ritz at the Carlton, and I'm trying to think of some of the other hotels, the Ritz Hotel hotels. He ran the kitchens and elevated cooking to such a level, and also was the one who introduced Americans to fine dining and the art of cooking. His cookbook, which obviously was printed in French, was translated anonymously in 1941. It was for the American audience. And there was also an English translation for it as well. So they have used the American translation for the cookbook. But taking out excerpts from it and playing with them, there's one that is calf's head giant, which is, you know, something that you make if people just drop in, as they say.
Or my favorite one is seared roebuck.
I love seared roebuck. Because it's such a play. It's like sears roebuck, but seared roebuck. But roebuck is a deer. I mean, it's venison. And that's the term. And if you read Escoffier's recipe, it in its own right, according to me anyway, is really pretty funny, because he goes through this whole process of describing you want the roebuck when it's ambushed because you don't want it to run too much. And, you know, I mean, it's just very elaborate in terms of when the meat is just going to be absolutely pristine. So I can understand just, you know, reading it where they would say, oh, this is so good. We have to work with this. And they did. I mean, they just took out those excerpts and then played around with them a little bit, actually sort of shortened his recipe. But also there were editor's notes, and they would invent their own editor's notes. And it was also, it was written in the way sort of fussy foodies and snobs, food snobs, would write it. Like, you know, this can only be picked on the southern side of the hill in certain months. And I mean, just that kind of elaborate stuff that we still see today. I mean, that's
yes, no, I don't write that way. But others do. There's a recipe for chocolate balls with Chambord liqueur, which is this wonderful blackberry liqueur. So it's very, very rich, if you can imagine these wonderful truffle-like confections. But the instructions for those are to be served only with no-cal ginger ale and to very thin people.
Yes.
So, you know, it's really just kind of a delight. Another favorite one is the gefilte of fighting fish. So instead of gefilte, fish. And you go to Max's fish hatchery.
In the Bronx.
Mm-hmm. So again, it's very much situating it in this New York life. And you get two fighting fish. Mm-hmm. We're not sure what those would be.
They're gefilte fish.
Right. And then you put them in seawater when you get them home, which actually, you know, by Jewish tradition, you would get your carp and you would put it in the bathtub, not necessarily with seawater, but certainly in bathtub water to keep them fresh until you're ready to make it and get rid of sort of the muddiness of the carp. And then you let them fight it out until all the bones are gone.
Yeah, so they sort of fillet themselves.
Yeah.
You know, there they are.
And if it's Sabbath, you know, then you don't have to do any work because the fish are doing it all. So it's really pretty hilarious. And I know we talked about this yesterday, and you didn't want to give me a definitive answer, so I'm going to ask you again.
Uh-oh.
You've had the question, though. So are we to look at wild raspberries as a work of art, because after all, we think of Warhol as an artist, or more as a cultural artifact? Not that the two are necessarily exclusive, but where would you situate it?
Well, I feel the same way I felt yesterday, which is I actually think it's both, because it is a cultural artifact. It really does. It's a period piece. It really looks at the 1950s, and it captures it in a very unique way. The parody is very strong because of the references and the aesthetics of the page, the line drawings. Some of them, they're just so wonderful. Some of them, to me, are a little flat. But there are others that I could live with for the rest of my life.
Which are those? The piglet? The suckling pig?
I love the piglet. I love A&P surprise cake. Uh-huh. I love that, you know, pheasant under glass, that whole sort of under glass business.
And the Woody Allen peasant under glass. That's the one I like.
So that also shows up. And that's something that's pretty much gone now. I mean, I don't, isn't it?
You have to come to my house.
Oh, well, I will. I don't know. I think the drawings are really charming. And they do change because they had hired young kids to come to Susie's apartment and color the drawings. And so the books, none of the books really seem to be the same. I mean, they're lithographs. They're, as you can see in the exhibit, they're really large print format. And so the coloring is really very different. So there's that, that changes, and it really does change kind of the dynamics of the page. Mm-hmm. But so I'm still saying it's both. It's
okay. One of the things that really appeals to me about Warhol is how many different ways he thought about food, because it really is a leitmotif in his work. So we have this Wild Raspberries in 1959. Mm-hmm. And then he did this very bizarre film called Eat in 1963, in which Robert Indiana, who most of us know from Love. Does nothing for 40 minutes but eat a mushroom. And a cat comes in and out. I guess that's the greatest activity, but it's not a dynamic film, but it's really focused on eating. And then he did those two films, The Restaurant and also the Nude Restaurant. And then he did the wonderful Velvet Underground album cover in 1967. Mm-hmm. You know, it's very much my era, with the big yellow banana sticker that you can peel back and see the nude banana underneath, you know, very sexually charged. Mm-hmm. And the American Supermarket exhibition he contributed to. And my favorite being the Andy Mat project that he wanted to do in 1977, which was reconceiving the automat as the Andy Mat, but as a place for lonely people.
A restaurant for lonely people.
Get their food and take it to a private booth and watch television.
Yeah.
So can you describe the concept of that Andy Mat some more?
Well, it was suggested to him. It was a project that was proposed to him. And essentially, and this would be on, I think, Madison Avenue?
Yes.
And there would be little booths, and they would have pneumatic tubes.
Yeah.
And you would send in your order, and all of the food was frozen, but it was actually highly designed. I mean, it was food that was
Maxime de la Falaise, yes, who is the food columnist for Vogue, came up with the menu.
With the menus. The menus, I thought, were really pretty interesting. So you would order the food, and it would come to you. You didn't have to, you weren't bothered by anyone or anything. I mean, really, you were there. You could eat alone. There was no problem. It never got off the ground, as I understand, but it was a pretty elaborate plan. I mean, the proposal was...
I think there was something like many hundreds of thousands of dollars committed to it, but then there were tussles with the investors, as often happens in projects like this, and it didn't actually happen. But I was intrigued by the menu because you have the food columnist for Vogue, you know, so it's, again, this very Tony food that is being presented in Vogue, but she was suggesting serving things like shepherd's pie, you know, which is very down home.
Yeah, I think, and also it would all be prepared. It could be frozen, so then it, you know, the system was really set up so that it could easily, you know, work as a restaurant, but also there was this whole sort of possibility of takeout to it as well. Mm-hmm. That was part of it, just as a...
And he envisioned a chain, you know, throughout the United States, and if only we had one in Williamstown now, I think we'd change the whole tenor of the place. Well, the other thing that personally intrigues me, having spent the last 3 years thinking about sugar and sweets, is that Warhol was apparently obsessed with sweets. And his mother, when he was little, whenever he finished coloring a page of a coloring book, would give him candy. And I read, or maybe Matt, you told me this, now I can't remember whether it was in something I read or the email from you, but he came back from Europe through customs once, and his bag was searched, and they opened it, and it was filled with candy bars and cookies and all kinds of sweets, and they were just sort of blown away. And he was known at dinner parties not to really eat the regular food, but to only say that, I don't want to get near protein, all I want is sugar. Mm-hmm. And his cake recipe was taking a candy bar and putting it between two slices of white bread.
So yeah, I think that's good. I like that.
And he did that wonderful poster for Lifesavers. So, I mean, do you have any, Susan contributed to this companion on sweets. Do you have any thoughts about him and Sweet Tooth? And
Well, because I have a sweet tooth as well, that was one of the things that I really liked about, you know, reading his diaries and reading his philosophy. There was sort of a judgment about how much candy he would work for candy, and that he realized that he had made it when he had rooms full of candy. I don't remember it verbatim, but I remember thinking about that, and just that sense of wealth was equated with chocolate, and I thought that was perfectly fine. I mean, I'm sure my financial planner wouldn't, but you know that was fine. But I also understand that it was really part of his routine to go see his clients, make the rounds, and then treat himself with some really elaborate pastry. And then the royal pastry, the chocolate balls that you were talking about, mm-hmm. are you actually go there and you buy them, and then you bring them back and you put them on a nice platter and then serve them with no-cal ginger ale. But
so do you think, and now we're psychologizing and speculating, but does this desire for sweet things and for reward with candy come from the relative deprivation of his childhood, do you think? I mean, I'm just curious what you think, having immersed yourself in him so much.
I think that's not an unreasonable speculation. But then there's a part of me that just feels like, you know, who doesn't like, I mean, sweets are a human, you know, it's a universal taste. I mean, people don't maybe like sugar or the umami taste or bitter or something, but sweet is a universal for humans. So, I mean, you know, who doesn't like dessert?
I mean, I think it's interesting to think about that obsession with sweet things and with desserts. How many of you have been into the recreation of Warhol's library here? You need to visit it. It's really wonderful. Yeah. And it has many of the books that were in, does it have all or just a selection of?
A small
selection. But looking at them, there are a huge number, well, relatively, I'm always exaggerating, but there's a very large number of diet books.
Yeah.
And not just diet books, but also body image books. Like, there were a few titles that really intrigued me.
The Fat Boy book?
Well, 30 Days to a Beautiful Bottom, as though you can have a beautiful bottom in 30 days.
Really?
Yes, I know. How to Get Rid of Your Double Chin in Just 6 Weeks. So, I mean, it's all kind of time sensitive with an urgency. And Thin Thighs in 30 Days. And he had his own diet. It was the Andy Warhol New York City diet.
Do you want to talk about that? This is so good. I think it's absolutely brilliant. I wish I could do it. But you go to a restaurant and you order something that you absolutely don't like. And then, you know, while you're having conversation with everyone, you're just sort of moving your food around, but you don't like it, so you're not eating it. So, you know, you really do keep your weight down. I read that, and I thought, oh.
It is brilliant, but the poignant sort of coda to that is that he really didn't ever want leftovers, and that's why I think it goes back to a kind of deprived childhood and thinking about the meaning of food. So he would always have, even at the fanciest restaurants, he would have his meal wrapped up, you know, a doggy bag kind of thing, and then he would take it and he would put it on a street corner in New York so that someone homeless could find it, and maybe not like a meal from La Grenouille, but maybe, you know, have this extraordinary experience. Mm-hmm. Or else take leftovers. There was a quote from him saying that my hairdresser's cat gets pate twice a week. I felt really guilty when I was quickly feeding our cat tonight before coming here, and I thought, oh no, this isn't pate. But we want to open it up to questions soon. Is there anything else that you particularly want to comment on, Susan, before we turn it over to the crowd?
Well, I would just really suggest looking at the book and reading the recipe, because they really are funny. I mean, they're great. It's just as you get to see a side of the 50s, especially for those of us who, you know, lived through them. There are things that are sort of shades of childhood, shades of the changes that this country went through in terms of food and what was deemed important or not. It's really easy to kind of flip through it, but it's worth reading it. And the other part of it is that Julia Warhola, his mother, was the one who wrote the recipes, which her handwriting is used quite a lot in his commercial work as well, in some of the other books. So you'll see things that are repeated. You'll see mistakes that are made, and some of them are funny just because of what the mistake is. Like Princess Grace becomes Princess Greca, things like that. There's a charm to it, and there's it also does sort of mimic what we all probably do. Well, I say we all do, but I know we do. You know, we write down, we get a recipe from someone, or we ask someone to write a recipe for us, and they do. And we look at that, and it reminds us of times and people and places. And so it does mimic that kind of personal manuscript.
Mm-hmm. I'm glad you brought up how it reflects the 50s, because when I was studying the book to prepare for this, I had an epiphany that explained, I finally understood myself. It made me remember Hostess with the Mostess and Pearl Mesta. I don't know if that name is familiar to any of you. She was the ambassador to Luxembourg in the late 30s, early 40s, and was known for her just fantastic dinner parties. And I think that sense of this is what entertaining is about, sort of the mm-hmm. over-the-topness, mm-hmm. but also making fun of, you know, why do you need to entertain that way? That phrase came back to me, and I thought, that's embedded in me from childhood. So here we are.
Well, there are actually people represented. Richard Rogers' wife, Dorothy, was Amy Vanderbilt, referred to her as the walking epitome of grace. So it, you know, there, the people who are represented were the recipes. I mean, Escoffier, the chef, attributed recipes to celebrities and aristocrats and people he wanted to curry favor with and their coquettes. And I mean, you know, this. And they do the same thing. So you have quite a number of names of people that you'll recognize that are part of it. But also his personal friends are there. Carrie Cadillac, Ted Carey's family's business, is in there. Dick Camp was Richard Camp Antiques, where he bought a lot of Americana. So it does embed celebrity culture, but it also there are people who are specific to his own crowd, his own group.
Do you know how many were printed and how well they sold of the wild raspberries?
I think the assumption is that probably 100 were printed. The wonderful thing about this, when I started doing the work, you know, there was information. But now that the time capsules are being cataloged, there's so much more information about Warhol and all the other projects coming out of that, you know, things are changing. She and her son Jamie reprinted the book in 1997, and in the preface to that, she talked about trying to sell them to Rizzoli and Doubleday bookstores, but apparently they weren't very successful, so they gave them as Christmas presents. Yeah.
And someone,
or holiday presents,
and who was
I should
it
say.
Who gave it back because they didn't want it?
See, they had given one to Janet Lee and Tony Curtis, who were married at the time, and that one was given back because apparently they didn't want it. So,
yeah. So it wasn't a bestseller.
Yeah, to answer your question, no, it was not a bestseller. In fact, the bookstores apparently weren't interested at all in it.
You were talking about how at your age, or at the person you are, things resonated in the work. And I just want to tell a little story. I was auditing the critical theory course by Mark Axhausen, and one of the girls did a beautiful presentation in which she put up iconic art. One of the pictures she put up was Jackie. You know, Jackie, bent head, pillbox house. And after she didn't refer him, just said, this is an iconic thing. I said, you know where that picture came from? And she said, yeah, it was in a magazine, or it was in a newspaper. Well, it was in every newspaper in America, and she's standing next to Lyndon Johnson, and a child, she was 19 or 20, just was not part of her scene. So I wonder if older people are going to enjoy this more richly. Perhaps.
Oh, enjoy Warhol's Wild Raspberries more richly?
No, just his whole work.
No, I think he it speaks to many, yeah. Many generations.
They just became friends and started working together. Did they do anything afterwards? Or was it just a kind of one-off fun project they did?
They became really fast friends, and for a while, according to her, had lunch at the Plaza Hotel every day. But they had other common interests, and also Suzie Frankfurt's husband is Stephen O. Frankfurt, and you may know him from doing the credits for To Kill a Mockingbird. He had won an award for that, and he was a graphic designer, very well known, and they all became friends, although Suzie and he divorced in the late 60s. But yeah, they traveled together. There, in his diary, there are many, actually very funny stories. There are times when he paints her in a way that just makes me wish that I had met her. Red hair, big frizzy red hair, and she was always well dressed. In fact, at one point she wanted to design clothes for women who are, quote, over the hill. So, you know, that they wouldn't, I guess, look so frumpy, but which never really worked. But she became a very important interior decorator. And very well known, and she was often enough, would be interviewed by various papers, including the New Yorker, for her suggestions for different things. And there was one point when there was a recession, and they were talking about, you know, ways to still live a glamorous life, and she was referred to as one of the beautiful people. I mean, that was the quote. They both were really interested in collecting jewelry, and she wrote the preface to the catalog to the jewelry collection that was sold at Sotheby's after his death. I think with any friendship, that things kind of come and go, but I think that they had stayed friends lifelong. And also, in the show we did at the Warhol, the family was gracious enough to send some of the pieces that he had given her, which were really quite nice. But she knew, she was a designer for Robert Mapplethorpe, who also photographed her house, her interiors, which are really quite nice. She worked for Robert Redford. I mean, she was really well known and was in the same sort of circle that he traveled in. But Warhol there were things that he said about her that were really funny. I mean, one that comes to the top of my head was that they had gone somewhere, I think to Miami or somewhere, and she had pre-written the thank you notes. She was like so organized. And I don't know, I just, you know, she's really a person that I always will wish that I have, you know, that I had met. But she lived here. She lived in New York and then downsized her house. In fact, she had a party. And he talks about the finger food. She made really nice little sandwiches, which, according to him, he ate 40 of. But
they must have had jam or chocolate.
Actually, he didn't even actually say. But this get together was to bring her friends over, and she wanted to sell, you know, the pieces in her house because she was downsizing. So it's just, I thought, such a brilliant way to do it because, you know, it's like, oh, you want this? Well, how about this? Yeah. Okay. So I think she was a complete and total character.
I'm wondering if there are any precursors to this, any other spoof cookbooks with a lot of flamboyant art in them? Or is it one of a kind?
For Warhol or?
No, in general.
In general. Toulouse-Lautrec's recipes were put together by one of his friends, and there were two recipes. I could only remember the name of one of them, but it was something like St. John Grilled. Yeah,
I'm not remembering.
But it was, you know, yeah. How to grill a saint was part of it.
And then I'm thinking of two, yeah, Marinetti's famous futurist cookbook, I mean, which he took completely seriously, so it wasn't intended as a spoof, even if we sort of look at it as a parody of the whole thing, but he was very, that was published in 1931 or 32, mm-hmm. and he was very anti-pasta because he felt that was what was literally dragging the Italians down. And my students, what was it, 10 years ago or so, made this unbelievable futurist banquet based on his recipes using lasers from the physics department instead of, you know, the infrared stuff that he suggested. And it's an extraordinary cookbook, but not exactly a spoof. The only one I can think of is by this Russian artist named Mikhail Larionov. He was married to Goncharova, whom you might have heard of because she's a little bit more famous. But in 1914, he had a project to write a cookbook with very outre recipes. And what interests me particularly is his idea of outre was to season chicken with vanilla, which of course now, you know, we wouldn't consider, it might not be particularly delicious, but it wouldn't be particularly strange. But for a Russian to take something in the sweet spectrum and put it with chicken was very odd. And I spent so much time in archives in Moscow looking for this and couldn't find any trace, so I don't think it was actually ever published, but a description of it appeared in a newspaper article. Mm-hmm. And I can't think of anything else before.
I mean, these aren't authors that, cookbook authors that I think anyone really knows. It's sort of one-off pieces, but there were books that were written about, like, if you have one martini, this is what you can make. And then it kind of goes on, if you have five martinis, this is what you're reduced to, which is basically, Ritz crackers and cheese. So there are books like
Peg
that.
Or Peg Bracken's The I Hate to Cook book.
Oh, yeah.
Which is amazing. Yeah. Taking all of that hostessy stuff and mm-hmm. what you're supposed to be doing as the perfect wife and the perfect housewife and just saying, I refuse to do it, and this is what I'm doing.
But
and
I
that's
think
a
that
real
would,
classic.
Yeah, I think
but
she
that's
was
kind
of serious about.
Alice B. Toklas's cookbook, is a really seminal one. Yeah. So, but nothing that was done so much as an art project as this, I would say.
If someone set out today to do a spoof of contemporary culinary elitism, what do you think the target would be?
Yeah.
Molecular
gastronomy.
It's really easy to do. Yeah. We actually talked about it a little bit in class today. Fusion cuisine.
Well, for example, go on, like, for us. Oh.
Foam of lobster.
Yeah. Or, I mean, what is very close to my heart, but I also have a distance at the same time, is what has been named the world's greatest restaurant, Noma, in Copenhagen, and the new Nordic style of eating. And one of the dishes there, which is extraordinary in any number of ways, is beautifully, perfectly caramelized onions, which are very sweet, because their sweetness has been brought out through very slow cooking, topped with tiny wood ants. And ants have formic acid, so you get the sweet and sour, but it's very easy to make fun of that kind of effete recipe. Mm-hmm. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Suzie.
Thank you.